the notes, which is the way I should have done it, and put them on the web. It isn't very many pages, like 500 pages. Today, what I'd like to do is turn to another problem involving magnetic fields, target quantum mechanics and magnetic fields. This is a case of the magnetic monopole, which was a case studied by Dirac back in the 1930s and led to some surprising results. Magnetic monopole is a hypothetical particle, one's never been observed. But if it did exist, it was a particle that would have a magnetic field that looks just like the electric field of an ordinary charge particle, like Coulomb's law. So if I call mu the strength of the magnetic particle, it would have a magnetic field that would look like this, r over r squared times mu. This is placing the monopole, magnetic monopole, the origin of the system of coordinates. So the magnetic field lines, the vectors, excuse me, are coming out of the origin like this, if we measure the charged particle. If you take the divergence of this magnetic field, what you get is a non-zero result, 4 pi mu times the Dirac delta function of the origin. It's zero everywhere except at the location of the monopole. But what this means is that the usual Maxwell equation of del dot b equals zero is not satisfied anymore. It's satisfied everywhere except effectively in an infinitesimal region around the particle. But there it's not. Anyway, that's the basics of the magnetic monopole. Now, magnetic monopole has never been observed, but they're dearly loved by theorists, and there's certainly objects that theorists take seriously, and this, who knows whether they'll be observed someday. In the meantime, there's been active searches, experimental searches, to look for magnetic monopoles, and in order to do that, you need to know where are you most likely to find them? So studying monopoles is actually quite relevant to physics. In any case, if a monopole existed, this would be the magnetic field. Now, I'd like to study today, or take a look at anyway, the quantum mechanics of, let's say, an electron moving in the field of a magnetic monopole. We'll assume the monopole is infinitely massive, so that it's like a magnetic version of the central force problem you see. Of course, in order to incorporate the magnetic field into the Schrodinger equation, we need a vector potential. So a vector potential is going to be a vector potential, A such that B is equal to del cross A. The usual theorems of calculus tell you that if you have a field whose divergence is equal to zero, then it can be written as the curl of a vector potential in this case. That means we have to exclude the origin here because that's where del dot b is not equal to zero. And so A can only be defined in the region away from the origin and kind of cut that point out. This was not surprising. You'd expect the potential to go to infinity, the origin anyway, be singular and not defined there. All right, we'll do this in the spherical coordinates r, theta, and phi. And I'll just summarize the results. If you write out the curl in the spherical coordinates and you put in the given form for B to the switch node's radial component, it's quite straightforward to solve it for a vector potential that satisfies this equation. The answer is not unique because the answer for a vector potential is never unique and always subjected to a gauge transformation. But there's one answer that comes out that's not very hard to do from looking at the formula for a curl in the spherical coordinates, and it is this. It's the magnetic monopole strength U times 1 minus cosine theta divided by r sine theta times phi hat. This is a vector potential which is purely phi direction. And you can check for yourself not only that it's easy to derive this, but also if you take the curl of it, it gives you the desired magnetic field. Notice, by the way, the magnetic vector potential does not have the same symmetry as the magnetic field. The magnetic field is symmetric under all rotations, because it's obviously rotationally invariant, whereas the vector potential is only symmetric under rotations about the z-axis. That's why it's in the phi direction. But anyway, it works. All right. Now, there is a problem, however, with the vector potential, which is the sine theta in the denominator, because that goes to zero when theta is equal to zero or pi. So theta equals zero or pi are places where we need to look at whether this vector potential is possibly singular. Zero or pi, of course, zero, theta equals zero is the positive z-axis, and theta equals pi is the dotted line of the negative z-axis. So we're talking about singularities on the z-axis. Well, if theta is close to zero, the denominator is also close to zero, but the numerator is also close to zero because 1 minus cosine theta goes to zero in the numerator. In fact, it goes to zero like cosine, like theta squared, whereas the denominator only goes to zero like theta. The result of this is that A actually has a well-defined limit on the positive z-axis, and it's actually smooth there, in spite of appearances. However, on the negative z-axis, where cosine theta is minus 1, then the numerator becomes plus 2 divided by sine theta, which is small, goes to 0. And so this one diverges on the negative z-axis. And so we'll indicate that by putting a wiggly line here going down the negative z-axis. This is the line upon which the vector potential is singular. So really only a half line. And this line is called the string of the monopole. It really shouldn't be called the string of the monopole. It's really the string of the vector potential. The monopole field is perfectly well behaved in the negative z-axis. It's because of the rotational symmetry. But when you get the vector potential, you have this singularity in the negative z-axis. Now, by doing a gauge transformation, it turns out we can move the string around and put it in different directions. Just to give you an example, let's notice that if we compute the gradient of the azimuthal angle phi, and do it in spherical coordinates, look up the formula of the gradient, you'll find that this is equal to 1 over r sine theta times phi hat. And so by adding multiples of the gradient of phi, in effect, this one term here multiplied by mu over r sine theta, one term is really an exact gradient. So let's consider a gauge transformation in which we'll subtract. Let's subtract twice mu times the gradient of phi from this earlier vector potential. And we'll change that 1 there into a minus 1. So this gives us a new vector potential A, which is overall minus 1 plus cosine theta divided by times mu divided by r sine theta times phi hat. So it's a second vector potential related to the first one by a gauge transformation. Now, the reason I set this up this way is because 1 plus cosine theta goes to 0 on the negative z-axis, where cosine theta goes to minus 1. But on the positive z-axis, where 1 plus cosine theta goes to 2, we're dividing 2 by a small number, and it diverges there. The result is this vector potential, from x, y, and z, has a singularity in the positive z-axis, which I'll indicate by a squiggly line, and it's the string in this case. So, in other words, by doing a gauge transformation, we move the string from the negative to the positive z-axis. Now, let's give some names to these two vector potentials. This vector potential over here is well-behaved in the northern hemisphere. The only place it's really bad is on the negative z-axis. But in particular, it's well-behaved in the northern hemisphere, and it only goes bad when you get down towards the South Pole. So let's call this, put an in subscript on this, and call this north regular gauge, meaning that it's regular and well-behaved in the northern hemisphere, actually even continuing down in the southern hemisphere, but don't go to the South Pole. Likewise, this gauge is well-behaved in the southern hemisphere. It only diverges when you get up to the North Pole. So let's call this AS, standing for south regular gauge. It's these two gauges. And then the gauge transformation looks like this, is that A north is equal to A south plus 2 mu times the gradient of phi. This is the explicit gauge transformation connected with. Now, the question that arises is whether it's even possible, because these strings are appearing here, the singularities which we don't like, the question arises whether it's possible to do a gauge transformation to get rid of the string altogether. In other words, is there a vector potential that's well-behaved and smooth everywhere that satisfies this equation everywhere? And the answer is no, and you can prove it this way. Prove it by contradiction. Let's suppose there is a smooth, well-behaved vector potential that gives the monopole field in everywhere in all directions. Now, of course, the origin itself is singular, we know that. But let's just cut a little small sphere around the origin out and just talk about everything else away from r equals 0. Is it possible to have a vector potential in that region which is well-behaved everywhere? The answer is no, because if we take a monopole here, and let's construct a sphere of some radius around it, and let's cut off an end cap on the sphere. Let's draw it like this. Here's an end cap, some radius. And let's integrate the vector potential around this loop here. So the idea here is to prove this by contradiction. We will assume that there is a smooth vector potential that gives B equals del cross A. I'll show you that leads to a contradiction. So if we integrate this smooth vector potential around this closed loop here, that's of course by Stokes' theorem, is equal to integral magnetic field over the surface. We'll call it B dot dA. Here's magnetic field sticking out everywhere. Let's say the surface has some radius. It doesn't matter what the radius is. Call the radius capital R. Now, what we want to do is to allow, so you may think about this as the limit of where you started out with a circle that surrounds a disk, flat disk. Then you take your finger and you punch the disk in and make it bow in, you create a bulge like that with a circle. And then you shrink the circle down like this, like it blows off a sphere. That's what we're ending up with here. So as we allow this hole in the sphere to shrink down smaller and smaller, it's clear the magnetic flux on the right-hand side approaches the total magnetic flux of the monopole going up through the sphere. So in the limit that the circle goes to zero, if I take the circle going to zero, then the right-hand side turns into 4 pi u, which is the net magnetic flux of this monopole here, by Gauss's law. On the other hand, the a dot dl must go to zero because the length of the curve is going to zero, and we're assuming that a is smooth. So you get a contradiction, it's clearly wrong. As long as the strength of the monopole is non-zero, this is clearly wrong. And so the assumption that there exists a smooth A is wrong. And therefore, we must live with the presence of these monopole strings, or singularities of some type. Now, this means that we need to work in patches if we want to deal with smooth functions. We can deal with two patches here, one that covers the northern hemisphere using the north regular gauge, and one that covers the southern hemisphere using south regular gauge. Let's allow these two, let's extend the north regular gauge a little bit over the equator down into the southern hemisphere, and the south regular gauge a little bit over the equator into the northern hemisphere, so there's an overlap region around the equator. I'll just sketch this for you like this, and say here's a sphere of some radius, here's the equator going through here. Let's say the north, so here's the north pole, here's the south pole. So the north regular gauge will allow to extend like this. We could actually push it all the way down to the south pole, but we don't need to do that. Let's just push it a little bit beyond the equator. And likewise, the south regular gauge, let's push it around the equator here, like this. So this is the region of definition of the north regular gauge, and this is the region of definition of the south regular gauge. And if you do that, then there's a strip around the equator in which both gauges are defined. And in that strip, one can do a gauge transformation to go from one to the other. All right. So each gauge is smooth in its respective region. This is covering the manifold with patches. Now, when we turn to quantum mechanics, we know that when you change the gauge transformation, you also need to change the wave function. So the wave function for this electron is actually going to be two of them. There's going to be one in the north region and one in the south region. Let's call these sine north and psi south. And these are related by a gauge transformation. And the only thing that's hard to remember is the sine, so I worked it out. And this is e to the, it's e to the, this is an electron with a charge q equals minus e. So you have to take that into account. But you look for the formula for the gauge transformation. And it involves, for negative charge particles, involves minus E over H bar C times the gauge scalar, but the gauge scalar is right here, it's 2 mu times phi, so multiply times 2 mu times phi, where phi is the azimuthal angle. And this is what applies, this gauge transformation applies in the equatorial strip, where the two patches overlap. So in particular, this is the exponential of a constant times the azimuthal angle. Now, wave functions have to be smooth in any one of these two patches. Why is that? Because in the first place, there's a solution to the Schrodinger equation in those two patches, and the vector potential is smooth in those two patches. And so you get smooth solutions, you have to, or else you won't satisfy the Schrodinger equation. Also, wave functions are single value. And the reason for that is that they're the expansion of the state, the quantum state, in a position eigenvector. So you have the expansion coefficients are unique. Now there's really two different expansion coefficients depending on the gauge. Why is that? It's because when you do a gauge transformation, it's equivalent to changing the phases of the position eigenvector. However, that does not change the fact that there is a unique expansion in terms of a given relative to a given phase convention for the basis states of the unique expansion. The result of this is that both psi north and psi south must be smooth everywhere, in particular in the overlap region. And therefore, this function must be smooth also. And this function is a function of phi, which is periodic in both bounds, 0 to 2 pi. And so this function can be smooth only if the coefficient is an integer. And so what we find is that the consistency of quantum mechanics requires that this product here, which is twice e mu divided by h bar c, must equal to an integer n. Now this can be written in various ways, and this is Dirac's main conclusion of this analysis. This can be written in various ways as the product of the electric charge times the magnetic charge is an integer. Let me write it this way. It's equal to h bar c divided by 2 times an integer. That's one way of writing it. Another way of writing it is to say the electric charge is h bar c over 2 mu times an integer. And this is the one that Dirac particularly calls attention to. Because what this says is that if there exists a monopole anywhere in the universe, even just one, with charge mu, then quantum mechanics requires the charge on the charged particles must be quantized in an integer multiple of this unit. And so this is potentially, would be an explanation for the quantization of electric charge if monopoles exist. Anyway, this is the tip of the iceberg of a host of theoretical considerations that revolve around monopoles. And as I say, they're certainly taken seriously today, even though they've experimentally never been observed. One doesn't necessarily have to have electric monopoles, but even monopoles for other kinds of fields as well, and those are certainly actively observed. All right, this is the main point of the Dirac analysis of the monopole. Notice we never had to solve the Schrodinger equation. We just found some constraints on it based on a single value of the wave function at gauge transformations.
Can you explain why it only requires one monopole? Like why the solution of this one trivial example can extend to both the laws of?
Why does it require only one monopole? Because if there were one monopole anywhere, it would mean that the wave function of the electron in the field of that monopole, the electron charge would have to be an integer multiple of that quantity in round brackets.
But why wouldn't that field be screened out? Why would that
be?
So are we saying that field
would
permeate through the entire universe and affect every charged particle
that's in the universe? Well, let's just take our electron and bring it close to the monopole. I mean, if there are other monopoles around of opposite charges, yes, you could get screened, but it doesn't matter because all you need is to, you can take a monopole and bring an electron close to it. So quantum mechanics then requires that the electron charge be an integer multiple of the inverse of the magnetic charge. The product of the electric and magnetic charges, that has to be an integer times HCO2, yes.
How is the quantization affected if the magnetic monopoles have different values? They're both ordinary monopoles.
Well, then nothing would make any sense. You'd have to go back to the beginning and probably revise a lot of basic physics. And that would be inconsistent with quantum mechanics. I mean, since monopoles have never been observed, of course, I mean, anything, you know, something is not verified experimentally, who knows what's going to happen, so this remains to be seen. By the way, Buford Price in our department was quite active in looking for monopoles sometime in the past, and there's a history here at Berkeley of looking for monopoles. I don't know if he's still involved, but yes.
Sorry, what do you need to look for then?
Well, monopole would behave in a magnetic field the way an electron would behave in an electric field. So, for example, the Earth's dipole field would suck monopoles into the North Pole, and then, and then, uh,
bring them out south. Well, I guess it'll be a flux of monopoles through the areas. So that's one of the things that people look for. It would also it also have a big impact on in terms of interacting with electrons. If you had a monopole moving through like a gas in a proportional chamber or something, it would create a lot of ionization. And I know at one point there was a plan to cover the roof of the Bevatron with detectors that would look for heavy ionization tracks, and they were going to test it out by using uranium. Because uranium fissions and produces these large charged particles that they give heavy ionization tracks. That was going to be how they test out the equipment under the missiles. They never did the experiment, but that was an idea. Okay. Okay, so that's magnetic monopoles. That's all I want to say about charged particles and magnetic fields, and now I'd like to turn to a new topic which will occupy us for a while, which is the subject of rotations in quantum mechanics. And I want to get through it as quickly as possible because there's a lot of physical applications that depend on it. So before we get into rotations in quantum mechanics, I want to say some things about rotations in classical mechanics, or one might even say just classical geometry of space. So let's begin by plopping down an inertial frame with coordinates x, y, and z. This is an inertial frame. And by the way, the definition of an inertial frame in Newtonian mechanics is that it's a frame in which Newton's laws hold. This means, in particular, that the trajectories of free particles are straight lines in which the particle moves with constant velocity. If that's, that's your definition, then inertial frames are not unique because you can translate them and rotate them and even boost them relative one to another. But here we're just going to pick one inertial frame. The same definition, by the way, also applies in special relativity, that inertial frame is a frame in which, which free particles move on straight lines with constant velocities. Whether this is relativistic or non-relativistic, it's not going to matter for the material I'm presenting today because we're only going to be considering spatial rotations and not involve any end of time. It's not going to enter in any way. All right, well, let's take this to the inertial frame. And by notation, allow me to write the coordinates as either x, y, and z, or x1, y, x1, x2, and x3, just for convenience. And let's also take the unit vectors x hat, y hat, and z hat, and write them in an alternative notation as e hat 1, e hat 2, and e hat 3. If we take a vector in this space and we call it v doesn't mean magnetic field, it just means some vector, then you can, of course, expand this as a linear combination of the basis vectors e hat, e sub I times coefficients vi, like this. Let's also talk about dot products. The dot product of two vectors v times c. This is, of course, the sum on I of VI times CI. This follows from the fact that the unit vectors are orthonormal. By the way, this assumption requires an assumption that the geometry of space is Euclidean, which would also make that assumption. These are all these assumptions that we're talking about here can all be tested experimentally. And in fact, it's known that the geometry of space is not really Euclidean, but it is a very good degree of approximation. So we've used this. And by way of notation, allow me also to write the scalar product of two vectors in a kind of a bracket notation with rounding brackets, just b times c. This will be useful later on for clarifying dot products. All right. Now, having done that, allow me to define what I'll call a rotation operator. This is a rotation operator that acts on space. So I'll call it R, and it maps space into itself. And what I mean by space here is it maps points of space which can be identified relative to the origin of this inertial frame. And it is an operator that satisfies a couple of properties. One of them is that if you let R act on the origin of our coordinate system, which I'll call script O, it acts on the O and it leaves O alone, so the origin is invariant under this mapping. And the second one is that if you let R act on any vector B, then its length is the same as the length of the original vector B. You can square this too if you want. It's the same equation, really. Its lengths are positive. So in other words, a rotation for us will be a transformation that takes points of space into themselves in such a way that the origin is left invariant, and also in such a way that all links are preserved. Now, if you preserve links, you also preserve angles, because angles can be represented in terms of links. And so this means that straight lines go into straight lines, triangles go into congruent triangles with the same links of the sides and areas, et cetera, et cetera. All right. And these facts imply, it can be shown, that R is a linear operator. That is to say, that if you let R act in a linear combination, let me call it dV plus cc, lowercase letters are numbers and uppercase letters are vectors. But this is the same as V of R acting on a capital V plus lowercase c, R acting on a capital C. I won't prove this. You can actually prove it without too much trouble if you think about it. I don't want to waste too much time or spend too much time on the axiomatic details of this setup, because most of what I'm saying is quite plausible anyway. But this is a fact, that this is a linear operator. Now, that means in particular that if I take a vector b and I write it as a sum of the basis vectors, let me call it bj times b sub j as a coefficient, sum of j, it means that if I apply a rotation operator to both sides, so rb, and you draw a picture here, here's the vector b, let's make the rotated vector, call it b prime. So the rotation is moved it from one place to the other. So let's call this b prime is equal to r times b. This is the same thing as the sum on j, of the rotation operator acting on the unit vectors, ej, times the coefficients b sub j. However, let's take the b prime and expand that also in terms of the basis vectors. It's the sum on I of basis vectors e hat I times expansion coefficients, I'll call bi prime. So notice that bi primes are the expansion coefficients of the rotated vector with respect to our inertial frame. Well, we can solve for the coefficients of the rotated vector in terms of the coefficients of the original vector. If we just take this equation and dot both sides with e hat I, because I'll pick out a single term of this equation. And if we do this, what we get is we get b prime I is equal to the sum on j of the scalar product, which I'll write this way, is bi, scalar product of r acting on bj, times b sub j. And now let's take this scalar product here and just define this to be what I'll call rij, which is to say those are the numbers that make up the components of a rotation matrix. It's a 3x3 matrix. And so the result is we have the simple result that b prime I is the sum on j of our rotation matrix rij times b sub j. This is the transformation. This is how the components of a vector change under applying a rotation. Okay. So that's not really simple. So this introduces the rotation matrix. Notice that the rotation matrix there is defined in a manner similar to matrix elements in quantum mechanics. That is to say, the rotation matrix is really the matrix element of the rotation operator with respect to the unit vectors of our inertial frame. It's the same mathematical structure. All right. Let me say some things now about the active and passive points of view. Whenever you deal with symmetries in quantum mechanics or anywhere else, you need to have an eraser so you can erase the board and finish saying what you need to say. So excuse me for a moment. Obviously steal this eraser won't touch it. Steal it back. So there's two points of view in applying symmetries in quantum mechanics or anywhere else in physics. And the one that I presented up here in this top board is called the active point of view. The active point of view is one in which you use only one coordinate system, What you do is you take some physical system here. Think of this vector as pointing to some part of your apparatus or some physical system. And you take your physical system and you rotate it to a new place or new orientation, like this. That's why it's called active, because you're really taking physics and changing it. The passive point of view, however, uses two coordinates. So in other words, here there's an old vector and a new vector, but there's only one coordinate system. That's the active point of view. In the passive point of view, what you have is two coordinate systems, an old coordinate system and a new one, but you only have one vector. So you take a given physical situation and describe it in two different ways by two different coordinate systems. So let me show you how the passive point of view works. So first of all, we've got our inertial frame x, y, and z. So in other words, this is all active up here. But let me talk about passive down here now. So you've got your original inertial frame like this, and then we talk about a rotating frame. It has axes, let's call them x prime, y prime, and z prime, like this. Okay. And if we have unit vectors describing the initial, the original frame, we have transformed unit vectors describing the new frame. So let's write this this way. Let's let the d prime i's, the e i's with a prime on them, be the unit vectors on the prime frame. Yes.
Question: so in the active point of view, where did we use the fact that this is an inertial frame?
We use that fact when we start to apply this physically. At this point, I'm really just describing the geometry. And I can put this in purely mathematical terms about transformations on, you know, Euclidean R3 or something like that. But the point is that you can't talk about points of space, you know, in terms of x, y, and z coordinates, unless you've got a coordinate system. So that's why I introduced the inertial frame. But in any case, in the passive point of view, you have two frames.
Right.
Okay. In any case, you don't have to use inertial frames to describe physics. You can have rotating frames and all kinds of things, you know, Coriolis effects appear and so on. But I'm going to be talking about just inertial frames now. And I'll repeat that this actually applies also in special relativity, as far as everything I'm going to say today is concerned, because it won't be really in time transformations. All right. So let's call the unit vectors of the rotated frame the prime unit vectors. And let's let R be the rotation operator in the same sense as the board above, which maps the unit vectors of the unrotated frame into the rotated frame. The original frame, the old frame into the new frame. All right. Now then, let's take our vector B and let's expand it with coefficients bi with respect to the old basis vectors. And let's expand it again in a different way with coefficients bi prime with respect to the new basis vectors. And now the original problem is to find the components of the vector with respect to the new frame in terms of the components with respect to the old frame. Well, on the right-hand side, just plugging in the definition of d prime I, this is the sum on I of our rotation operator applied to d hat I, that's the vector, multiplied times d prime I. In fact, if you'll allow me, since I is a dummy index, let me change this to a j, the summation here. Now that, on the other hand, is equal to e I times b I. So if I dot both sides with e hat I, what do I get? On the left-hand side, I get b sub I. On the right-hand side, I get the sum on j. And then I get a dot product of b I with r acting on bj. That's the same as you see up here for the rotation matrix. So it becomes Rij times B prime J. And this is the passive law, transformation law. Compared to the active transformation law, the primes and unprimes have been reversed. And also the meaning of primes and unprimes are different now. While the unprime BI is the same in both places, that represents the components of the vector with respect to the original frame. From the active point of view, that's the only frame there is. And the B prime I is the components of the rotated vector with respect to the original frame. Here, the B prime J's are the components of the original, one and only, that there is only one vector, it's drawn in, but with respect to the rotated frame. So there's a different interpretation of the symbols, And also, the matrix gets converted into its inverse in these two different interpretations. So I just warn you now, we're pretty consistently in this course, we're going to, as much as possible, stick with the active interpretation. But in other courses and lots of books, you'll see the passive point of view. So you, whenever you compare the two, you need to be aware that there's going to be a reinterpretation of the meanings of the symbols, and also the matrices typically go into their inverses. All right, we won't use passive point of view very much. Active point of view is really better. All right. Now, the next thing to say is that I'll go back to these properties of rotations that they preserve links. As you see, the idea of a rotation operator acting on a vector, which is what we mean here, gets translated into matrix multiplication times the vector in a different sense, the sense of the triplet of numbers over here. But the formula looks the same. The new vector is r times the old vector. In any case, since the magnitude or magnitude squared of a vector is preserved under a rotation, that's the definition of a rotation. In vector matrix language, you can write it like this. Is that, let's write it as R acting on B, this vector squared. This can be written the same thing as the vector B transpose times R times B. But this is matrix vector language. The same thing, by definition, the rotation operator is the square of B, which is the same thing as B transpose times B. And since B is an arbitrary vector here, this has to hold for eigenvalue identity in here if you like. Since B is an arbitrary vector here, this implies that R transpose R is equal to the identity. And this implies that R transpose is equal to R inverse, which, as I'm sure you know, means that R is an orthogonal matrix. It's the definition of orthogonality. It's orthogonal, so R is orthogonal. And this in turn implies that R times R transpose, that is to say, in the other order, is equal to the identity. So these are all properties that follow from the preservation of links. Now, from these properties, it follows rather easily that the product of two rotations is another rotation. It follows that rotations are invertible because the transpose is the same as the inverse. So they always have a non-zero determinant. You can find their inverse. And it also follows that that the inverse of a rotation is a rotation. And these are the usual properties you need to establish. These are the axioms or definitions of a group. It means that the set of rotation matrices forms a group. And this group is given a standard name in mathematical physics. It's called O3. The O means orthogonal, and the 3 means they're 3x3 matrices. It's just notation for the set of these matrices. Right. So the set of 3x3 matrices, it preserves distances and therefore angles, forms the group O3. Now there's something else we can ask for too, however. We can ask whether or not the rotation, for example, here I'm mapping an old set of unit vectors from one inertial frame into another set of a rotated frame, whether this preserves a handedness of the frame. So suppose the old frame is right-handed. In fact, I meant to say that up there. Let's choose our inertial frame to be a right-handed frame. Now the question is the rotated frame right-handed? And the answer is that it depends on the rotation matrix. Here's how this works out. Let's take this equation of R transpose R is equal to the identity, and let's take the determinant of both sides. Well, the determinant of the product of matrices is the same as the product of the determinants. And the determinant of the transpose is the same as the determinant of the original matrix. So, taking the determinant of both sides, what we get is the determinant of R squared is equal to 1, which is the determinant of the identity. And so, by taking the square root, what we find is that the determinant of R is either equal to plus 1 or also is equal to minus 1. There certainly are rotation matrices, elements of O3, whose determinant is equal to minus 1. If you want to see an example of that, here's a matrix we'll see appearing in the future. I'll call it P. It's got minus 1s in the diagonal and zeros everywhere else. This is a matrix which is orthogonal, but its determinant obviously is minus 1. So it's in the second class here. The first class where the determinant is plus 1 are called proper rotations.
and the ones where the determinants minus 1 are improper rotations. And this matrix P is an example of an improper rotation. This is also called spatial inversion because it takes a vector, as you can see, if an x on the vector just multiplies it by minus 1. So it takes a vector and it flips it through the origin to point in the other direction. This is, in fact, at the level of classical spatial operations, this is the equivalent of the parity operator that we'll talk about later in the course. In any case, this is an example of an improper rotation. Now, the set of proper rotations all by itself also forms a group, and this is called SO3, where the word S is just terminology. It's a word that's supposed to mean special. And what special means in this context, i.e., is that the determinant is equal to 1 plus 1. That's the meaning of special. So the proper rotations are orthogonal matrices whose determinant is plus 1. Now the improper rotations don't form a group because they don't have an identity element. But it's true that if you take the union of these two sets, the proper and the improper rotations, then you get the group, which is O3. So actually, SO3 is a subgroup of O3, where the distinction characteristic is determinant is plus 1. All right, so those are the main elements of the rotation group, O3 and SO3. Now, next, I'd like to say some things about the parameterization of the rotations. There's actually two common parameterizations that are used. One's called the axis angle parameterization, and the other is the Euler angles. I'll tell you about the axis angle parameterization first, but in some ways it's a simpler one. So the idea of the axis angle parameterization, I think, is quite simple and plausible geometrically. An axis is identified with a unit vector I'll call n hat, except you can extend it out an arbitrary length. And the rotation about an axis by an angle theta is a rotation that uses the right-hand rule about the axis to rotate points of space around it. I think it's clear geometrically what that means. This is proper rotations only. It rotates about an axis like this. Let's call this rotation r n hat comma theta. And this, in fact, is what I mean by the axis angle parameterization of a rotation to specify the axis and the angle. Now, it's a fact that every proper rotation can be written in axis angle form. This is something I won't prove. It's actually a fairly easy thing to do. But I think it's also plausible, if you think about what rotations do, that every rotation has an axis. And then there's some angle that it rotates about the axis to fill in the rest of the information about the rotation. I mean, the idea is to prove that every rotation has an axis. An axis is a vector that the rotation acts on and doesn't do anything to it, leaves it invariant. So an axis, you see, is a vector which is an eigenvector of the rotation matrix with eigenvalue plus 1. And if you really want to prove this, you start by showing that every rotation matrix has an eigenvalue of plus 1. Anyway, this is the notation we'll use for rotations in axis angle form. Now, it's pretty easy to work out a formula that tells us what happens if we take a rotation in axis angle form and apply it to an arbitrary vector, which I'll just call u here. Let's let u be an arbitrary vector. We want to write out the right-hand side. We want to write out a formula for this, something being the form. It's pretty easy to work out what this is just by doing some geometry drawing pictures. So first of all, let me draw the unit vector n hat, which defines the axis, and as before, let me extend it on the outside. Well, let's say that our vector u is some vector like this. It's not necessarily a unit vector, so it sticks out longer. And we're going to rotate this by an angle theta about the axis. And it's clear what that will do is take this vector u and rotate it in a cone about the axis, swing it out in a cone. So the tip of the vector u is going to move on a circle like this, which is, if I draw it well, which is centered on the axis of the rotation. We can take this vector u and we can decompose it, first of all, into its component, which is parallel to the axis, and then its component, which is perpendicular to the axis, like this. We can call this part u parallel, and we can call this part u perpendicular. Now, first of all, what is u parallel? parallels pretty easy to work out. It's n hat times n hat dotted in u. You just get the component of u along the direction n hat and multiply by n hat. As far as u purpose concerned, what is that? Well, that's just the total u minus u parallel. And if you work this out, this is the same thing as this can be written this way as n hat cross with u, that quantity cross with n hat, the triple product of the rule. This final expression was the same thing as the one above. All right. Let's look at this. So in this continuum, this picture I've drawn so far, if you rotate this u by some angle theta, you can write this u perp like this. Here's u perp. Obviously, it's not going to change u parallel, but it's going to rotate u perp in the plane here, which is perpendicular to the axis. It'll move it over to a new position like this, where there's an angle theta as the rotation angle. So it might be easier to visualize this if you look at it from above, like this. Let's say here's the u perp direction, like this. So here's our vector u perp sticking down here. And then let's draw a vector the same length. It's sort of like local x and y directions that I'm imposing here in this perpendicular plane. And there's a circle like this. So let's say this is the vector here, which is n hat cross u cross n hat, which is the same thing as u perp. And let's let this vector here is the same as n hat cross with u. So on this picture here, here's my local n hat in this direction. If I take this and cross this with u, it's going to give me a vector like that, which is n hat cross u. That serves like the local y-axis. And then crossing that and n hat moves it in this direction, gives me like the local x-axis like this. And then here's the rotating vector here, my angle theta. And so if you draw pictures like that, it's pretty clear what this answer has to be. It's going to leave u parallel invariant. It doesn't change that. So the u parallel, here it is. It's n hat times n hat dotted in u. And then we have just a two-dimensional rotation in this plane perpendicular. So it's going to be a cosine theta times u perp, this original u perp, sine theta times this n hat cross u. So it becomes plus cosine theta times n hat cross u. Cross with n hat plus sine theta times n hat cross with u. Right? Now, I'm going to clean this formula up a little bit by expanding out that triple product. In fact, I did so already. Here it is. Here's the expansion right here. There's a component, a part proportional to u itself, and there's a part proportional to u parallel, which is the same as this quantity here. So if we put this all together, let me put it over here where I can put a box about it. This r of n hat comma theta applied to an arbitrary vector u is equal to u itself times cosine theta. That comes from this u right here, plugging in there. Plus 1 minus cosine theta times n hat cross times, excuse me, times n hat. Times n hat dotted with u. And then finally, plus sine theta times n hat crossed u. And this is a convenient form for a rotation operator in axis angle form acting on an arbitrary vector. Okay. Now, from this formula, you can set n hat equals to x hat, y hat, or z hat, and work out the rotation matrices for rotations about the three axes. And if you do that, you get this stuff that I summarized from the board before class. Here they are. Don't bother to copy it down. It's all in the notes. But these are the usual rotation matrices about the three axes, which I think you can see the structure of them. For example, rotating about the z-axis is really rotation in the xy plane. There's the 2x2 rotation matrix in the xy plane, and it doesn't do anything to the z direction. That's why you've got zeros and ones here. All three of these matrices block diagonalize in the same kind of way. All right. Good. Now,
there's something else I can do with this formula, which I could run it before. Let's do something else with this formula. Let's take the special case in which the angle theta is small, much less than 1. When cosine theta is essentially equal to 1, 1 minus cosine theta is 0, and sine theta goes over to theta. That's what it is in the first order in theta anyway. So for a small angle, what we get is that r of n hat comma theta acting on a vector u is just equal to u itself, and then the second term is 0, and the sine theta just turns into theta times n hat cross with u. If you want to be careful about what this formula means, let me just say there's another term here, which is the order of theta squared. This is the formula that's valid through first order in theta. So this is a rotation, an arbitrary rotation applied to an arbitrary vector for small angles. And you can see that the small angle correction is a new vector which is orthogonal to the original vector. So that just means that any given vector, if you rotate it by small angle, it's going to move in some direction which is orthogonal to it. It's pretty clear it's going to move on the surface of a sphere in a small angle of motion. It's got to be, the increment has got to be perpendicular to the original vector. That's what this is. It's in n cross u. All right. Now, there's another point of view on infinitesimal, or this is what people might call infinitesimal rotation, meaning rotation for a small angle. There's another point of view on small angle rotations, which is quite easy to work out. And that is just to say, if the rotation is small, then the rotation matrix must be a small correction applied to the identity. So this is, again, a small angle rotation. And the idea here is that here's your rotation matrix, here's the identity, and then the correction matrix I'll write as epsilon times A. The epsilon here is really only for psychological reasons. It's just a reminder that this is a small correction. I could just omit the epsilon and remember that A itself was small. Anyway, let's write it this way. Then, given the fact that R transpose times R is the identity, or RR transpose is also the identity, this is the same thing as identity plus epsilon A multiplying times identity plus epsilon A transpose. And if you multiply this out, you get identity plus epsilon times A plus A transpose plus order epsilon squared. There was an order epsilon squared above here too. And so, but since the whole thing has to equal the identity, it means that the order epsilon term has to vanish. And so what this implies is that A plus A transpose is equal to 0, or A transpose is equal to minus A, or in other words, A is anti-symmetric. So if you form the small correction to an identity matrix to create a small angle or infinitesimal rotation, the correction matrix is an anti-symmetric matrix. And I guess I'll stop here. Up to this point. Okay.